communication. Of course, there is many common themes that are raised by the library building, but I think in many ways it's a very important point of focus in terms of the discussion of ornament, that of image, surface, the relationship between opacity and transparency and translucency. Many of the topics of modernism are, in a way, rethought, reproblematized in the context of this building. And the format for this evening is going to be that Jacques will make a very brief presentation focusing on this project and one or two other schemes that deal with the whole discussion of image. And then I am going to ask Mark first, Mark Cousins and Andrew Benjamin, to give a very brief response, in a sense, to Jacques' presentation. I will then maybe ask one or two questions, and then we'll open it to the audience, if you're still here with us with this heat and everything else. So without any further delay, please welcome Jacques Herzog.
Start showing things before they are really ready. Also, because you're students, there's a certain danger that you realize things on your plan before we even publish it in our book. So that's more of a problem. Everything is going really fast. The fastest is pictures, images. The one thing, one of the aspects, I guess, of our discussion, which is the role of images in cultures, not only today, but earlier. And, well, I just wanted to start with this. I will present just a very few slides of three projects. Some of them are really old projects, like 12 years old or 13 years old, when we started wondering in which way images, printed, painted, whatever, could play a role in contemporary architecture, a role that has been denied, has been almost been criminalized in modernism in the 20th century. Some of you are too young to know about that. But the 20th century is in some way the age of the century of no figurative images in architecture, namely people such as Adolf Loos have criminalized images. They have super racist attitude, like in a super racist attitude, being criminalizing people who are tattooed and looking at people who have tattooed bodies like minor cultures. So the role of figurative images, or the importance of figurative and the meaning of figurative images today and in the, let's say, in the middle of the 20th century, and at the beginning of the 20th century has been changing many times. So can I have the first slide? The first project where we really dealt with the image, because we also had to, was a project, a competition for a Greek Orthodox Church that we were planning for Zurich. This shows an image of an Orthodox church in former Yugoslavia, where one example, I don't know the name and the place of the church, where you can see that painted spaces where basically the image was replacing architecture, architecture being reduced to almost a schematic space, which we also like in some way, which is a figure in itself, the house with the roof, the very simple shape, and the paintings on the wall to contemporary eyes, I would say 90% of you, or even not more, don't know anything about these images. But in fact, the images are not just nice or not nice, blue, red, or yellow, etc., but they are icons, which means they are images which tell a whole story. They are images which in the philosophy, which is based in Platon's texts, mean something which reveal something which we don't see, reveal something eternal, reveal something like archaic images. An icon is more than just a painting like we have it in the Western world and we have and we put on the wall. So the icon in some way is something repeated in every church in this culture. For instance, also similar, the same saints, the same stories, the same, I don't know all the names in English, but I think it's good enough to say that the images are not only repeated in the different spaces, but they are always sitting in the similar places. Like, for instance, this could be, I don't know, Saint Nicholas. I don't know the name in English, is that right, name? You know, and the saints have the similar places. So the position within the space is the same thing. So people who were coming here, like you, going to the movie or like going to a theater, knew exactly, you know, that this meant this and this story, this and this, how should I say this, this world. There was a whole world behind these images. And contemporary, next one please. This is another shot of this same space. That's more likely to be the place where St. Nicholas is in the cupola space, in the choir, and it has other icons where St. Mary plays a certain role, etc., etc. And great artists have interpreted the same thing in a more accurate or in a more contemporary way than others. But mostly, and that's the basic information, the basic idea about icons, it's not the artist which is in the center of the work of art, but it's the icon itself. So the artist steps back. Something which is totally unimaginable in the Western world is a reality and an icon. So in fact, the artist behind doesn't play an important role. And that is interesting, even as a contemporary instrument, but also fatal in a way that today you couldn't do that anymore, because today you cannot believe an artist, even remote, somewhere in the mountains of Greece, could be inspired in the same old-fashioned way to do the same quality kind of icons as at that time. So we, from the very beginning, denied the idea of building an Orthodox church based on the same tradition, which means by painting, hand-painting icons with this very moralistic, today very moralistic, attitude of the artist not being in the center of the picture. But it's a crucial moment in what is an image. Next one. You have painted spaces or spaces which are filled with images also in Central Europe. This is an example of Switzerland, a chapel in the mountains, in the Swiss Alps, where some of the paintings are left and basically are based on the same approach, the same idea of the space, the painted space replacing the built space, of the painted space becoming a mental space, almost a virtual space, and a spiritual space rather than a physical space. Next one. Our project, in our project, we tried to go back to the very old idea of the icon, trying to avoid that contemporary today's artists would, in an old-fashioned way, paint icons. And how could we do that? We know that one of the ideas of the icon is not only the anonymous existence of the artist, but also the fact that you could not isolate one icon from the idea of the space, even from the odor, from the entire idea of the space, from the space as something which could not be split into parts. Here, we try to build a space which would be built with translucent marble, Greek marble, onto which we would etch with silkscreen printing method photographs of old icons which we would blow up. And those icons would come from collections all over the world. So it would be icons that now exist, let's say, in a loft space in New York, and one would come from Switzerland, the other one would come from London or wherever, and would build together like a kind of a patchwork. It would be like a reconstruction of an Orthodox space with the means of photography, which is something like the icon is, which is repeated, endless repetition, which is the idea of the end of the icon. The same theme, the same image, the same name, the same saint would be represented endlessly. And suddenly you can see from there, next one, it would have made an unbelievably beautiful building, perhaps the most beautiful we could ever do. But the bishop and the jury wanted this building badly, but the bishop, who is the intellectual leader and the spiritual leader of the community today, was against that. So we couldn't do it. But it was something which really, this intellectual moment to understand what icons really mean and what contemporary painting, contemporary movies, contemporary video, contemporary images versus that idea of icons mean, next one, was at the beginning also of, you could see vaguely some of the images tattooed or etched onto these slabs here, like portraits of Maria and other saints, etc. So daylight would filter through this concrete, through these marble slabs, and also we liked, of course, the idea of having the image of the natural, the veins of the stone mixed with the artificial image of the icon. Next one. We started to really be interested in the image of a space-making element for architecture, for contemporary architecture. And we used anything. This is, I think, typical for architects, that you can apply things to different moments, a church, a factory, a store, a museum, whatever. You take whatever you can to sort of understand how things work. And Ricola, who is one of our most interesting, most addicted, most committed client, offered us to do this factory in France near Basel, where we used one image only. This is a photography of of Karl Blossfeldt, where we use the image in a very different way, but to create a space. And unlike the Greek Orthodox Church here, we played with the visibility of the image, with the vague moment and the very visible, with daylight, with artificial light, with inside, outside, with landscape versus architecture. Daylight shines through the canopy and reveals the image very clearly. Next one. Whilst the main facade remains almost like a solid wall, even if it's a very transparent, very translucent, light-filled wall here. But during daylight, it seems almost opaque, whilst the canopy is revealing the fact that it's clad with these images. Next one. And, of course, also, we introduce this concrete wall on the left, on the far right, where rainwater, which is collected on the roof, drips down, falls down, and turns the very solid concrete wall into a seemingly transparent opening. So it's the paradox plays a big role, where the transparent or the translucent seems to be opaque on the left-hand side, and the solid seems to be more open, more transparent. So we engage natural processes with artificial character of materials and also of the image. Next one. Of course, at night, the whole thing is reversed. The wall becomes very transparent and becomes almost like a big sign, like a big lamp in the surrounding, in the neighborhood. Next one. From inside, during the day, the fact that the wall is translucent creates like a connection between the interior space with the landscape outside. So the relationship between inside and outside is very strongly challenged, very strongly becomes very strongly an issue, a different kind of issue than, let's say, modernism, where inside out was just one thing, where you tried to get rid of any material, where you had the structure, like ideally in Mies Farnsworth House, where you have the structure and the glass doesn't play a role as material. Here, the translucent or the transparency is materialized. Next one. So that's another aspect of images, let's say. The image itself is of not great interest, unlike the icon, where the images are, as I said, very much a world in itself. Here, we tried to look for something. We did try many things. I could have brought all these slides till we found this one. This is a photograph of by Karl Blossfeldt, who's a photographer of the 1920s, who did pictures of natural objects, such as leaves, branches, etc., where he was interested into this moment where something natural, like this leaf, is an ambiguous picture of something almost geometrical, almost abstract, with a little moment of figuration. So it's something between, shifting between natural and abstract. In a repetition, though, it was very helpful. It had something like a stone which is carved or so. Next one. Now, the third example, the library we are actually talking about, is in Eberswalde, which is a little town near Berlin. This is the area where the library needed to be built, which is a very eclectic area with nice buildings, historical styles, various styles. There was no homogeneous sort of typology. Different materials, different iconographical programs, etc. Next one. So we felt free. Next one. That's the existing library where the building we built was added to. Next one. We did the building, which is almost in a dumb way, just a box which is tattooed with images. And with this light, almost seems to be, as I said, tattooed, blind object. Next one. Sitting here in this corner and playing its role as a urbanistic role, as a stone in the mosaic which was completing this eye, this island here. We also did this building, which is done in brick. So these are all these buildings which are built in different styles. So we needed these two buildings to sort of complete what was meant to be a very simple, a plaza or a campus built with different styles. Next one. So it plays an urbanistic role, but of course there too, a bit like what I said about the Ricola thing, the light and the change of light and the change of season changes the whole thing. All of a sudden, this seemingly opaque, solid object becomes more lively, and you can understand that the different pictures are being applied on different materials, such as concrete and glass. The glass becoming more and more transparent and cutting the buildings in like layers. Next one. Even more so, of course, the darker it gets outside and revealing the structure of the building. So the building is not just this object, this urbanistic role, but also the structure, which is like three pieces put on top of each other, like three drawers, like storage of books. Because the plan is so reduced, so maximized, we have no space left to reinterpret the space as a public space inside. So we decided to go the other way, to put it to an extreme, like really a library thought as a storage of books, where between the books you had some space to read or to discover something. Next one. The darker it gets, as I said, the more this structure becomes actually the image of the building. But in fact, of course, the layers of images wrapping around like film stripes is based on a program that we gave away to an artist. We did this building in close collaboration with Thomas Ruff, who is one of the most important contemporary artists working with photography. And he, for him, the pictures, we will speak about that later, play a different role than for us. He had very clearly some political ideas and also compositional ideas, which we shared, of course, where to use which image on top, in the middle, etc., etc. Next one. You can find this in the booklet, but we'll speak about that later. Inside, originally, this is a simulation of what we wanted to do. We didn't get the control to do what we wanted inside. We wanted the band of images wrapping around, become visible inside, like the cover or the backside of books, sort of integrating the books themselves in the shelves of the library. So it should be very dense inside, super dense, where the images outside, the books, the text, so to speak, the mental side of the space would merge with the architectural theme, the architectural idea of the building. So in fact, it's not a project about surface. It's a project about compressing space, rather than the surface being detached from the idea of the building. In all the projects I presented, actually. Next one. Here's a section where you see all of these things, the urbanistic side with these two different types of building, the fact that it's just a simple box, the fact that in fact it is a storage or a laying up three drawers on top of each other, and the fact that the images and the books would do like one thing, would be like one material fitting out the interior space. Next one. A few more, two more images about what is actually on the images. Those are original Xeroxes of the images we wanted to apply to the facade. The top one, above the angel, is a very important image which every German understood. This is the moment where, I think in 61, the last people could escape from East Germany, later East Germany, to West Germany, when they understood that this was the moment where the wall would separate the two Germanies in two parts. And they would escape through the windows of that building. I think it's called Bernauer Straße. Bernauer Straße is the name of this street, which was cutting through Berlin. And Thomas, who's a very politically engaged person, wanted to have this image in the middle of this building. And the library, being in former East Germany, and all the professors being very aware, much more than we all are, of the political power of images, which played an important role in former East Germany, didn't accept this. So we insisted to have that, but we sort of cut through this by adding a third layer. You will see this in the booklet, with a more, different pictures. I have forgotten which one it was. Mm. So that this image was like broken. And of course it has other pictures which also play compositional roles, but also, I don't want to explain every single thing. Just one thing, maybe the angel here and the Cupido is a painting. All the others are coming from magazines and newspapers. Is based on paintings. All the images which are applied on glass are originally paintings. Next one. You also see another picture they didn't accept and we couldn't bring back, which is Richard Nixon and Brezhnev sitting on the bench. That was too clearly sort of fixing this moment of separation of the two Germanies. And of course, I don't know whether this is here, represented here, the skull, which is a very traditional element of still life, which plays a very important role in libraries, and that also they had a problem with, but we insisted on this being a very classical and very important image to be there. So the images themselves, obviously, were still so sharp and so important that there was quite a discussion on what we could select. It was not just the architectural or the decoration side of them which were left to discussion. Next one. And the reality at last, one of the same angel on the printed on glass, and this one here, this is a picture where three women are lying on the grass rooftop of a building in Berlin. The same image is near here. We wanted to have grass here that also they didn't accept. We didn't decide for these terrible things here. And also on the very top where we have grass, we have a grass roof. So the images are related to those who want to see it, to those who would like to look at the building more in detail, to the real position, to the real physical existence of the project. That's all the slides I have prepared for great. Today.
Thank you.
Before we start talking.
Thanks, sir.
So as I mentioned at the beginning, we will have two brief commentaries from Mark Cousins. For those of you who don't know Mark teaches here at the AA and he directs the General Studies and the History and Theory program in the graduate school. And also Andrew Benjamin, who teaches in the graduate school here, happens to teach a course on surface and architecture. And holds a professorship at Warwick University in philosophy. But we'll start with Mark, some comments.
Okay. I was extremely interested in your kind of description of the project. Myself, I kind of find that what you've done is kind of extremely enigmatic. I think it's both kind of very powerful, but it's going to take quite a lot of time in a way to kind of work out what's actually kind of going on. So in a sense, I think one could approach the whole question from two sides. I mean, one, the question of the relation between imagery, space and surfaces on the one hand, and perhaps the more traditional architectural question of kind of surface and structure on the other. Maybe, I mean, if Andrew's all right, I'll take like the first set of questions and maybe he would kind of deal with the question of surface and structure. Now, it seems to me that you use an interesting kind of number of historical precedents, each of which I think kind of work very differently as images in respect to the architectural space in which they kind of inhabit. You mentioned the icon to start with. Now, it seems to me that what happens with the icon as opposed to Western Christian kind of painting in architectural space is that one's whole relation to the icon is that one is drawn towards it. And that is what really organizes the space. That it is a kind of consuming. In respect to space, it is consuming the spectator, and the spectator has a wish ever to be closer. I mean, you rightly talked about the way in which the icon leads to a kind of notion of exact copying, which is, of course, entirely alien to Western European notions of artistic contribution. I think one could almost say, you know, that as it were, the icon painter is put in the position of attempting to be a sort of Xeroxing of Christ before the technology. And I mean, I think it's quite interesting to actually go back historically and to ask of a number of historical situations, given like the fundamental fantasy that they had, what was the desired technology that they wanted, even though they didn't have it? And I think that becomes quite an interesting question in respect to the material processes which you're using. When one moves to sort of traditional kind of painting and architectural space, say within Western Christian traditions of, say, mural painting within buildings, there it seems to me the relationship is very different, because the building, the immediate surroundings of the building are there to support, in some sense, the narrative space opened up by the painting, and in a sense just to help situate the spectator from a sort of perspectival point of view rather than what you might call a relation of consuming intimacy. So you get a completely different relation of space, the building, and the image. That then brings the kind of difficult question of what it is, how does one interpret fully what you've done, and I don't pretend to in the kind of time that we have this evening. I was very interested that you used the notion of kind of tattoo, and perhaps one could pursue that for a moment. You talked about it in terms of producing an effect of liveliness, but I think there's another side to that, which is clearly one of the characteristics of tattooing the human body is that it stands as the mark actually of permanence. Now, looking at the kind of material process you've used, one thing that one needs to sharply distinguish it from is something that one might think about if one kind of just saw an image of your building, which is really that it was the site of projection of images. You know, that you could imagine, as it were, a building, you know, which was constituted of little screens upon which there were projections. That seems to be important to mark the absolute difference of that in what you've done. You've produced a kind of form of extreme permanence, actually, of the image. Now, you also talked about what I think you referred to as the criminalization of sort of figuration within modernism, and certainly projecting figuration onto architectural surfaces. Now, of course, the images that you've used are figurative in and of themselves, but when one looks at them in terms of the disposition of the whole and of the repetition of elements, one also begins, I think, to see a process of what you might call abstraction through figuration. Mm-hmm. I mean, normally abstraction mm-hmm. is thought of as a sort of an abstraction from figuration, mm-hmm. and it's almost by an excess of figuration, mm-hmm. you begin to reconfigure a kind of abstraction which in some sense we've urbanistically already got used to, although we've never quite put a name to it or even sort of put our finger on it. These really are just a few comments on what I do think to be an extremely enigmatic. I don't think there's a question that there's one simple kind of answer to this. I think that you have done something which it's going to take really quite a long time to absorb and to work out.
I wanted to begin by taking up, I think, two expressions you used, and that of space-making. I think compressing space was the other one. And it seems to me that the strength I've always found in your work is linked very much to that. It's, and especially the relationship between light and space-making. It seems to me the real strength, for me at least, of a lot of the Tate Modern resides very much in that and some of the other projects, which whilst I've not seen, I have seen in images. And I've always been interested in the way, for example, you use a juxtaposition of glass and concrete or glass and brickwork. And so I think there's a project that interests me enormously to do with space making. Now, what my area of worry concerns, I guess in a way that repeats some of Mark's points, is to do with the role of the image. Now, and how this functions in relation to space making or compressing space. Because you want to make the claim that this is not about surface, it's about compressing space. It's not, as it were, a repetition of Zempa, but it's something different. Now, just to provide some background, as you yourself said in the lecture, one of the interesting things, and I think intriguing things about images, is that they no longer have immediacy. When we look at a painting of an Annunciation, apart from a woman doing this, we actually, we moderns, we secular, do not know what's going on. Now, that lack of immediacy means that something has to fill the gap. There has to be some way of understanding these images which are no longer immediate. Now, one of the things that fulfills that is the academic study of art or art criticism in relation to traditional art or the art that's been given to us. I wonder, however, what happens with, you know, the repetition of images that are attributed some sort of status and yet still need that gap to be filled in to be understood. And it seems to me at that particular point something interesting emerges. Namely, that to the extent that there is a lack of immediacy, I don't understand the image though I may like it, or I don't see it immediately though I like the effect it has. I don't know about that building, but I recognize of the people coming from East Berlin into West Berlin, but I see it as an interesting building. To the extent that there is, I mean, to use the word, an enigmatic quality, or the way I would put it, a lack of immediacy, what one then has is a sort of pause before the image. And to the extent that that pause before the image is maintained, then what happens, and this is not a criticism, but merely a description, is that these surfaces work to convey a mood. They're not immediately objects of understanding or comprehension. They work to convey a mood. Now, in a church, it'll be a mood of calm or transcendence, or and one could begin to adumbrate a whole series of different moods and link images to moods. But the lack of immediacy, the pause, the creation of the mood, to my mind means, and again, not a criticism but a description, that the walls then function perfectly as ornament, precisely because they demand a pause and generate a mood. Now it seems to me that it's to misunderstand the tattoo much as it's to misunderstand the mask, not that you said this, but this is often a claim about them, is to see them as ornamental. One of the things about the mask in all rituals is you never see it as a surface behind which there's something else. This surface organizes activity around it. You look at the role of the mask in shamanism in Korea, and you can see that the different sorts of masks, which are surfaces, organize the ritual. So they're necessarily functional. Now, tattoos, traditionally, were equally functional. Mm-hmm. They weren't to be understood as the creation of anything enigmatic, though they may have become enigmatic. They, from Maori culture right through to elements of Asian culture, the role of the tattoo was always explicable in functional terms, even though it was, as it were, on the surface. Now, what that means is that to the extent that an analogy with the tattoo is made, then the distinction between function and surface, or between function and the conveying of mood, vanishes. Mm. And what one is left with is a surface that, as we say in English, that effects, that brings something about. And to that extent, the extent that a surface effects with an E, that it brings something about, it can't be seen merely, and the word merely is always problematic, but merely as that which conveys a mood, but it works in a certain way. Now it seems to me at that particular point, one could see a real distinction between a certain version of the modernist activity in architecture, in which, with Loos, for example, as you know, I mean, cladding works. The juxtaposition of volumetric space, the Raumplan, taken in conjunction with cladding, is the activity of the building. It doesn't create a mood, it has no ornamental effect, though it can be attributed one, but it works to realize the particular logic of the building. So to that extent, I would want to see a certain modernist tradition going from Zempa to Loos, in which the surface worked to effect, to bring something around. Now, there's clearly another tradition in which I'd want to locate what I'm seeing in your work in terms of a, as it were, literalization of the surface. It doesn't effect, it doesn't bring about, but it works as a literal surface. And to that extent, it works as, or it holds and has, the condition of ornament. And it would be very interesting to see that the real clash, and I think it would be a very interesting one to pursue, between the Eberswalde Library and its walls, the factory, etc., to juxtapose that with, as others have heard me talk about this before, Zempa's writing about Trajan's column, mm-hmm. for whom that the moment he talks about the gold, he talks about the carving, he talks about its urbanism, he will never want to separate anything to do with surface from what it effects, from what it brings about. And so I think, therefore, there is an important, I mean, an interesting conflict, it's an interesting gotcha. Conflict, between your use of the surface, with all its strengths and from an, as it were, Semperian position limitations, and what the Semperian Loosian tradition, which I think generates the current interest in topology, though they wouldn't know that. And the juxtaposition between that way of dealing with the surface and the way in which you do it. So I think there are, as it were, two tendencies in modernist architecture. Mm. One that, as it would be to put it in polemical terms, that ornamentalizes the surface, which is, again, not a criticism but a description, and the other which has a surface which works, which realizes things, and to that extent breaks with the hold of the literal surface. So my attempt, as it were, is merely, again, my favourite word, merely to situate two trajectories to play you off, if I could put it that way, against another reading of the surface.
May I just say one or two things? I have, strangely, never really read Semper's text, but I was always very intrigued by Semper as well as by the American guy, Sullivan. Semper, there is this, in Vienna, this famous two museums, the juxtaposition of these two buildings, which urbanistically are a masterwork, I think. You go out of a building, and in the very moment you go out of the building, you discover the same thing you just left on the other side of you, which is in itself a crazy idea. And the fact, I looked at these buildings and I thought something is different, even if he uses the same canon, do you say that in English? You know, the same Greek language of columns, and a little bit like in London, Hawksmoor, who does this also, but destroys everything that has ever been done before in the same way, using the same things. And in fact, we don't want to repeat things. I never thought of that before in the same way, but I think that Eberswalde destroys all attempts dealing with contemporary image that have been done before, because it's not the question, is it a surface or it is a space or compressed, whatever. It should be a bit of everything together, all together, because that makes the, what you call the enigmatic thing of it. Because I think the quality in what all of us perceive as a quality in daily life is when something is this and at the same time is that. You cannot just say, I like this because I have the full understanding of this icon, etc. It's getting boring. It has this, but at the same time it stimulates something else in yourself, you know? And ideally, a work of architecture can do that. And not always the things remain unpronounced or unresolved, but sometimes they do, and they create this kind of strangeness or balance between different interpretations. In the case of Eberswalde, I really think it has something between a very dumb, almost East German concrete building and something totally ephemeral, almost like a ghost. And because, I mean, you know that as an architect, you don't always know exactly how it comes out. And if you go there, you immediately know it works, it doesn't work. And you can never fully explain. But that ultimately, this is what you try to do, where the physical, also because that we never spoke about that, this is concrete. And it's pictures that are like edged under the top skin of the concrete. And you wouldn't say it's concrete. But when you're very close, then the grain of the concrete and the grain of the artificial image of the pixel structure are in a strange relationship. So this is very physical. This is very much, you know, like you look at this microphone here. It's different from the surface quality you perceive when you're far away.
Maybe you can speak about that a little bit more detailed, because this idea of taking the photograph from the newspapers,
yeah,
and actually going, the process that's involved from going from the newspaper to the surface of the building with the sgraffito, I think that maybe technically it would be a good thing to explain that.
It has both a technical and an artistic side. We asked Thomas Ruff, whom I mentioned before, who is the photographer who does these pictures you all have seen, for instance, the portraits, these straightforward portraits, they're always framed with these wooden frames, huge portraits. Or he does a series which is called Houses, he does another series which is called Stars. So he takes pictures of the universe. And I knew he has a collection of pictures he collects for some reason or another, like we all. In our daily lives, we discover sometimes pictures in a magazine or a newspaper, which for some reason or another attract us. Roland Barthes calls this the punctum. You know, there's something you cannot really explain. So he cut it out, put it in the drawer. This is his private collection. And this private collection, he takes sometimes pictures from there. He
takes pictures, photographs of them in a different format, saying that what is an anonymous picture that we all see is like the artist selects it, frame, discovers it, and makes it his own picture. I mean, that is his artistic strategy. We have nothing to do with this, which is an interesting strategy. Quite a few artists have this kind of a private archives. And I asked him from this archives, which I knew because he showed me a few things before, why don't we, or why don't you select pictures that have been somewhere and we turn them into architecture? And the technical process is something we have developed over the years and we've been using in an earlier project, which is the Pfaffenhäuser Sports Center, which allows us to take photographs, to turn the photographs into not digital, but
pixelated.
How do you say?
Pixelated.
Pixelated pictures, which then are applied on the paper by means of silk screen technique, and instead of using color, we use a chemical substance which works on concrete in the moment where it dries out and slows down this process of drying. So once the wall is poured or the concrete element is poured, you unveil it and you take down the wooden boards and you wash it very carefully so that those parts which are dried out remain and the ones which stay more liquid or slow down in the process of drying become pixels or points of this image. So it's very much like photographic paper, actually. It's really a photographic process. And we had quite a long time to really make this thing happen because it was very rough at the beginning. And now the pictures have quite a good photographic quality. But let's say after a few years, they become they fade away, like everything fades away. That was also a question of the client. What happens to the image? How long does it stay? What, you know?
I think this idea that there is that distinction between the print and the surface of the concrete, yeah. that it's not about the projection, exactly. but it's actually about the idea of erasure.
Yeah. And it's
and
not
also kind of carving.
Exactly. You know? And it's not painted on it or printed on it. It's more substantial. So it's really under the skin. And that's a huge difference, physically. And I find what you said very interesting. There's only one thing which doesn't... which is not actually our strategy. Maybe it's your perception. The question of immediate effect. Our architecture is normally very much on this, you know, that immediate physical, that almost... you know, almost physically, and at the same time, it creates a distance. So it's, again, this kind of a double strategy. And when you see that in a publication, of course, everybody said, well, this is quite something, and you haven't... And when you see, it's really like a heavy bulk, you know, that stands there. But at the same time, it's... what are these images? I mean, what does it mean? And some of them are ugly or uninteresting or you don't understand them, but they intrigue you for some reason. And
and tell us a little bit about the difference between, you started to refer to it, but about the difference between your perception of the building and its, in a sense, signification and Thomas's ideas about the photographs, maybe a little bit more. And just the issue of collaboration, how you...
I believe that architects don't know anything about images, and they know nothing about color. I don't know one architect in history who has ever used color in a decent way. But artists have spent their whole lives dealing only with this, so I find it very natural to work with people who are professionals. And artists such as Thomas are very interesting in their own way, and they make an interesting contribution to something, to your research. And so it was natural always in different projects
first of all, to work with an artist. And for him, the way he frames a picture, the fact that he uses something which is a painted image rather than a printed image for something different, that's his decision. And I find it interesting because the building gains more, whatever, energy or something, even if we may all not even become aware of that. So there was a lot that he was interested in, and that's his part and not ours. And ideally, in a collaboration between an architect and an artist, these things come together somehow, that both the work at the end is both something we couldn't have done without the artist or the artist without us. So it's a way he expresses images towards the world that he couldn't have done without architecture. And for him, he, as I said, he has this political side. For me, basically, I just wanted to have these repeated bands, stripes. So it was quite a superficial idea, even if then later I was very happy. He has these very strange images with Cupido and the angel, which are really images which are at the edge of being something kitsch. But if you see it in front of you, it's just really beautiful. And I'm so happy the artists give me the legitimation to use such images, you know. So I really need the artist. And this story of the Berlin Wall, this is his pleasure, but I find it interesting. And I found it interesting because we, of course, had to speak with the professors to convince them they should do this, you know. But there was a discussion, and it was subject that were raised through the fact that the artist was collaborating. It was not just that we bought a painting and put it in the building that we've done. It was not that kind of a collaboration where, or some anonymous art consultant orders, like in bank projects or so, you have some architecture, and of course you have some decent art. You have the Bill Viola, you have a big painting or a sculpture by, I don't know, Richard Deacon that you put in the lobby. That's a totally different thing, you know. That's something you can exchange. Here you cannot exchange anything. You are more than married, you know, or worse than married. No, more than married, more than married. It's something you cannot really detach.
I just wondered if I could just come back here, just to go out on a limb, as we say. It seems to me that in discussing the building thus far, we've talked about the surface of the building, however we all want to understand it. And I take very seriously your use of the word ephemeral, because ephemeral is a word that's often used pejoratively, but it can be used here. In some sense, the way the change that is going to take place through seasons, through light, etc., etc., has the consequence of its very ephemerality demonumentalizes the building. Mm-hmm. So in the East German context, this is probably a good thing rather than a bad thing. Yeah. So I'm very sympathetic to the process of an attempt of an architecture that demonumentalizes what's going on. Nonetheless, having said that, it seems to me that our discussion thus far, in staying on the surface, literally, has repeated something that is there, certainly in the way historians write about architecture, certainly in the way that theoreticians write about architecture, or used to. And that is that we've identified the architecture as the surface, or the outside. We've talked about it, and to that extent it fulfills a tradition running way back, but in our context from Ruskin, and Sullivan would be a very interesting case to talk about, but certainly we're there in Ruskin, where the architecture becomes the ornamentation. Everything else is simply form, or building, or tectonic, or something that engineers worry about. The architecture is ornament. Is the ornamental. And I suppose that part of the implicit critique, I suppose, in my reference to was there in my reference to Loos, is that of all the things that's interesting about Loos, and to my mind there are many, there is at least this one, namely that the surface works to realize the project of the building. In other words, within the Villa Mula, for example, the organization of space within the building is realized by the operation of the internal surfacing. So the cladding, as it were, works to realize its project as a domestic house. And it would indeed be to misunderstand the role of cladding in Loos to think that you could abstract it. You can't. You've always got it to see it as internal to and integral to the realization of the building's function. And I think that's what
without it ever being said. That's what Loos takes from Zempa, at least from Zempa's writings. Now, it seems to me that the implicit criticism, I suppose, if I could go out on a limb, I'd want to make is that my initial point of this conveying of mood, and therefore the surface fulfilling the condition of ornaments, is that the logic that's generating this surface is as yet, in our discussion of it, not driven through the building. And so it's as though this building could have a number of different demonumentalizing surfaces, or it could be a demonumentalizing building behind surface, behind which there could be a number of different things at work. And I suppose that while I don't want integrity in that everything has to be rigid and held in place and a total organized logic, it nonetheless does seem to me that there is a case to answer, that this ornamentalization of the surface, in literalizing it, leaves the interior untouched. And to that extent, and that accounts for why thus far we've talked merely about the outside.
But that's, I think that's just because we could not do the inside. And I think that we went quite a step further than Loos. I think that you were right what you were saying about Loos, and I'm very interested in Loos as well as Semper, but I found Loos intellectually a stupid guy. I'm very provocative. Because, you know, not only why should all letters be small, I mean, that's another story, but he works a lot of ornaments and uses it in a spatial way, and I totally agree with that. But, and the Raumplan is something he brought into architecture, and the very brutal way he almost treats Austrian culture, and he was perhaps one of the few, if not the only, interesting guy in the 20th century Austrian culture. And you know, that's again another story, provocative story.
Yes.
But at the same time, he's as racist as basically perhaps the whole of 20th century Austrian culture. Because he says what he said about the tattoo, and whether this here could be applied to the history of tattoo or not, that's a different thing. But the fact that you deny the importance of the image applied to a surface, skin or whatever, as something superficial in the bad way versus something substantial in the good way is deeply stupid, you know? Because not only the surface, even if it's totally detached from the inside, is never, ever really detached from the inside. Even a Madonna tattoo and some t-shirt, you know, that you buy somewhere in a Hollywood or in a Hong Kong store, is really something detached from culture, from the spirit of our time. So we could speak of how superficial things could be at all, you know? That's one thing. And the other thing is that in this case here, the idea of the building is basically that the image is the substance of everything. It's no question of structure versus space versus surface versus even people and books, but it's like one thing. It's like you had books and people and the history of the people, and you carve out the space, and that's the building. That's actually what we are striving for. And we, of course, didn't quite achieve it because we were not allowed to do everything inside. But that's the spirit, and more some of the more recent projects where we don't use at all images, you know, which are more tectonic or more structural or more formal.
I think that sort of Andrew's point kind of would be right up until you get to the point where you're discussing the actual image, because it seems to me if we were talking about, in some sense, projected images, then that might be true. But the material process through which your images come kind of really puts the image to an entirely different test. I mean, I think it's useful that you kind of referred to the Bart notion kind of the punctum. The image which you've produced is not one which kind of creates a pictorial space. It's one in which that space is always kind of fading away, in some sense, because of the actual process of its own production and fabrication. It's not in that sense a kind of a use of the image for, although it's figurative, it's not, shall we say, kind of illusionistic. And it's occupying a space of the image which arguments both for and against the image in the early part of the 20th century don't really account for. I mean, that's why I say in some sense it's enigmatic, because I don't think we've worked out what that permanent space of fading is, in which, as it were, it's the bisection of permanence and ephemerality. But it's why intuitively I think it's so important that the exact nature of that process of the image is like incredibly important to the project.
Maybe just before I open this to the floor, one thing that might also be good to touch on, going back to the church project at the beginning, this analogy between the concept of the content being the same and the role of the artist in the process, and the analogy between that and the work of architecture, in a way. I think maybe if you could touch on this, because it seems to me that while to a certain degree what Mark was saying about the concept of the Xeroxing of the icon or the repetition of the icon, which has a lot to do with the content, which at that stage presumably also that the church is very useful as a space which is used very much for educational purposes, because it's also bringing the lay people in there and really using those kinds of images. Nevertheless, there is the idea of the difference in terms of, despite this kind of suppression of the role of the artist, one's understanding that while the content is the same, there is still a certain sort of distinction that is made with the work of the artist. You can still distinguish the work that is good or the work that's not bad. Yes. So, in this sense, I think it would be interesting if you could speak about this idea of repetition, mm-hmm. and the way in which at times the content might be kept the same, mm-hmm. but the signature or the quality of the work itself becomes, the nuances of that become very specific, despite this kind of repetition of the content. That, I think, on the one hand, and then probably related to this, is this discussion about loss more generally applied to Swiss architecture, because if one follows your argument, it seems that what you're saying is that a lot of your colleagues in Switzerland are in some ways continuing the work of loss by asking for a kind of project of authenticity, which you are trying to deny. So can you speak about this issue of repetition? In what way are you repeating but you're distinguishing yourself, and how do you evaluate the Swiss kind of context? A lot of things, but
well,
maybe...
I think the second part is more of a political thing, which I have problems to speak about. Mm. But clearly the problem with this sort of tradition of minimalism or so is that it's always... Everybody is more than he or she wants, bound within a certain tradition of religious or cultural, whatever. And certainly the repetition of similar forms and also the excuse of the ornament being something almost criminal is, and to have that sort of certainty is like a legitimation for many people to go back to the very archaic, the simple forms, and this is like a moral argument, and this is deeply rooted in Protestantism. And then,
nevertheless, that's ornamental too.
Yeah, it's ornamental too. It's a very good, but this is what I really have really profound problems. I really think is a dead end in not only architecture but everywhere that you sort of work into this form only, where you seem to be born and where you seem to have your cultural roots, and at the same time finding this the one and only way to sort of describe the world. But I think the first question is more important or more interesting, the visibility of the personal, of the author, versus the invisibility. And not only in the context of history, where, of course, we all have seen visited museums where very early painting is always shifting between something schematic, you know, those paintings which have the gold leaf background, which we find so precious and so nice, and mostly standardized or schematic faces. And then all of a sudden, artists like Giotto and others come up and sort of destroy this. And through their personality of artists, bring in something new, and which is the genius of the single versus the traditional message that is repeated through them as well as others. And of course, we with our Western world, our eyes, try to discover the very genius moment of where, as you said, Asunción or the moment of the announcement of birth is for instance in Tiziano in Titian is unbelievable painting, and that, can you imagine, that was a shock to the world, and it was a shock especially to the other artist colleague, and that was perhaps the birth of the shock, because earlier I think that many artists were not so much striving for being different from the other one as now. And among artists, as much as architects, something you create and which is really a new thing is a shock. It's like that's how you exist and that's how you present yourself in this world, being different from the other. At the same time, you do a library, you fulfill the program, you have more or less the budget, which is okay, etc., etc. But at the same time, you do it for totally different reasons, for totally egoistic, egomaniac, maybe artistic reasons to do a contribution in this long history of bringing out or the genesis of works of art or of architecture, to create a piece which is different from the other. And that's the difference between a contemporary culture versus a traditional culture, where everything was sort of coming out of something which seemed to be given, which seemed to be normal, which seemed to be natural. Those are the terms that normally one uses. And we can't go back to that. So that's the only way. The question is only how good is it, how interesting it is, how much does it, you know, generate energy for other people to perceive something, to discover something. I personally don't know about architects so well, but I know about art. When you look at art, you know, I like to quote Tracy Emin, I need art just like I need God. I think this is a fantastic statement because it means that you need art to as something that you discover yourself. You perceive yourself by perceiving something. Whoever has done that, it's just something that you feel sharp, you feel sexy, you feel your body, you feel everything, because you have discovered something. And you discover this other person's talent to see the world in a different way. And that's ultimately the only really interesting thing, also in architecture, besides the fact that it works or that it was within the budget,
etc., etc.
Thank you.
Gustav. Do we have the microphone somewhere, please? Could you pass it to the front here? To... Can you just say who you are and speak?
My name is Gustav Metzler. And the one who
Can you speak up? Can you?
The one word that occurred to me as you were presenting your latest body was the word branding.
Now, the word?
The word branding.
Oh, I didn't mention it today, did I?
I haven't seen the book, and I've certainly not seen the building, but I have seen your tape gallery. And I have recently read that the tapes written in Jagmon has a department, or there is a department, to deal with branding, the branding of the tapes. Now, there's no question which one has the most successful branding, which is your tape. Yes, your tape. And then, and the article I read on the subject partly or largely the landing of the tape, it has attracted 3 million visitors.
Four.
I certainly don't want to criticize your work or this building, but it seems to me that without the branding, i.e. this graphic design, it would be a rather, it wouldn't make much of an impact. You know, I mean, I feel that. I think it would be regarded as a rather run-of-the-mill job. So,
what kind of a job?
A run-of-the-mill job, a rather ordinary one which might not get much attention in the architectural press. Again, I'm not criticizing, I'm just...
No?
And now, what is our problem? Our problem, especially in relation to your presentation, which
I'm sorry, what is? I didn't understand.
The problem about our problem is the absence of belief. The absence of belief. And what comes to mind here is an extraordinary image I just saw some time ago of Mexico City, where I leave the library, a cube, completely closed and no windows, no fenestration. A library itself is quite a shock. And it has a fantastic set of murals in terms of mosaic.
You mean the National Library in Mexico City with the mosaic around?
Yes, I would think so. Yes. Now, there you have belief. There is a belief there that comes through the imagery. One doesn't sense belief in the images, which is not surprising, because we don't have belief. Newspapers don't represent, don't even want to specify, project belief. So in that sense, it's a form of realism. But can we just make one more point? Without these photos, what, in fact, is the building? And the point was that the outside of the building and the inside of the building. Could you say something on that? Assuming we did not have this extraordinary, fantastic, and possibly unique, well, it is unique, presentation outside, how do you, would you judge your entire building?
Well, I said it's just a dumb box. But at the same time, it's also an interesting structure with the three drawers which are laid on top of each other. I think it always has this and this and this and this. But of course, you can see it. I think if you have a problem with this or that, or you see only this and think, well, besides the photos, this is really shit. I think this is perfect for me. Of course, I don't like that. I would like everybody, that everybody loves what we do. But I think it's really important that everybody has the perception he or she wants. And I, from what you say, I don't agree with a lot that you're saying, but from what you say, what I really like is that the Tate and the question of branding, whatever this is, the library, the photographs, this really intrigues you. It really makes your brain somehow move, and there's quite a turmoil. And I think this is the good thing. More than anything else, you would say, or I would answer you. The fact that it raises these very questions about believe or not believe, this is more important than these two philosophers, or me, who is someone who tries to defend himself anyway, giving you somehow arguments against or for what you were saying. You know what I'm trying to...
Thank you. Anyone else?
Take it away.
Can you pass it behind you all the way to the second window?
My question is...
Can you say who you are, please?
You're a nasty guy.
Federico Ferrari, first year student. Yeah, good.
My question is, do you think that it's possible to change the picture on the building with the time? And that this could be a new way to give a kind of dynamic and evolution to architecture?
Well, purely technically spoken, this in this building it would be difficult to replace one image by the other, because it's not a digital information, it's not a liquid crystal generated image, it's a very almost old-fashioned, substantial physical element, you know, these concrete things. So purely technical point, it would be difficult. For me, as I said, the images don't have the same meaning as for the artist, and because it's a work of art also, so I don't think it would be very interesting to exchange this versus another. But generally, I think things can change. But also the perception of the images will change. So the images change without you wanting to change them. Maybe you can spray on it or so. So.
You'd be happy about that?
I'm not happy about that. But it also depends on... We wanted, actually, always once do something with sprayed on facade, because this is certainly an expression of a very lively culture. And,
but I think it would be a completely different thing if you were able to change, because surely the whole point is that you make this, which comes from a particular period randomly through the newspaper, but once it's constructed, then it's there. And that permanence is the thing that provides the aura of the building. It gives it its time. So we know that this is also part of the kind of historicity of the work of Herzog de Meuron, which is now changing in time. But if it became this billboard thing, I think it would be a different kind of architecture than the one that you have been pursuing.
It fixes the building in time also.
There was a question back there, and then we'll come to the front here. Say a little bit more. What do you mean by design datum?
You have certain preoccupations that pervade your work, and I'd like to know where they come from, and you can explain their validity in relation to other items. What motivates your designs?
I think it would help the answer if you were more specific. Just like take one example of some situation that you're intrigued in the design. And
for example, the block that you mentioned. How did you decide that a block would be appropriate? And what is motivating the fact that a block should be appropriate there? And
a block, you mean the box?
The box,
the
sixth
rectangle.
Yeah, what gives that any more validity than something else?
Many reasons. Good point. Originally, like 20 years ago, the very first designs we did were geometrically quite complex, like curved, and very few people know that. Then we shifted to more rectangular shapes because we hated postmodernism and deconstructivism and all these things that came up, and we didn't understand when we worked against that in some way. It was like an instrument for us to become basic and really become visible for ourselves, not only towards the outside. So that was a very intentional move. And the more recent work, we are in dealing with very complex and very unexpected, let's put it mildly, shapes. And why? Because we want to discover everything in architecture. Color, light, surfaces, soft, hard, etc. Shape, whatever makes architecture, architecture. What is architecture is ultimately the question. So form or shape is one thing. The reason why we didn't do that in Eberswalde is, first of all, we didn't want to. Maybe we couldn't. It wouldn't have been appropriate in our way we interpreted the urbanistic situation. And also fourthly, because as I said, we couldn't, because very rarely something which is rectangular is really good, but at least it's not very, let's say, apparently
something painful because you felt the artist or the architect wanted to do something which was really unconventional and different from the other buildings, and which is unfortunately mostly the case. And there need to be very, very, very good arguments to do something. And having the pictures in a combination with something which is as a form, let's say, as unexpected, would have perhaps destroyed the whole thing. Because, as I said originally, the building is both anonymous and magic. And we like this just juxtaposition. So this form is the appropriate form. But in other projects, a totally different form might be appropriate. So all is based on the idea of the concept. What we try to build, you know, what we try to somehow construct or deconstruct or understand. A building is like a tool, like an instrument, which helps us to understand what this place misses or what we could do there, and how this place could change into something which makes it nicer.
Can you pass the microphone to the front here, please?
About those images that you repeat, and what is the idea of repeating images? Isn't it a little bit too like pop culture, like Andy Warhol did? He was also taking an image, and you know, and repeating, doing something, you know, taking them, and you know. And then I want to know what is your attitude to repeating and showing again all those pictures?
I think that
you repeat the question.
You were saying, giving the answer. I mean, two things. First of all, Andy was not an architect. I'm very happy he left us something. I must say that Andy Warhol is certainly one of the greatest artists in the 20th century. So he was right making these repetitions because it was a very new thing. I think in architecture is again different. Because, as you could see, for instance, in the factory, by repetition, the single image loses its figurative, its singularity, which we were never interested in anyway. So it reads as a wall, as if the picture becomes like a stone, one piece of many others. So repetition is clearly something different from not repetition. And I think you, Mose, I don't know who said that through the repetition, we destroy the image and it makes it more abstract. It makes it more, less something that you fix your eyes upon at this very image only. It's more, it leaves you more up to you, to the rest, which is also there.
You just get to ask one question only. That's why
I understand. No, I understand you.
No. Turn it up. Yeah, go on. Just speak.
By the way, one thing she said was very interesting. She said we shouldn't speak too long about the different things because the dissection of something is always a problem.
Yeah, then there's nothing else left because we will discuss everything and then. But anyway,
you can speak to the microphone. It's just
Okay, thanks. Well, you said that this repetition is a new thing in architecture, the repetition of the image. Okay, so maybe it's like digital image where you have pixels. Maybe it's like a new way of looking because, I mean, nowadays we don't have that standard images that we had in history, like icons, whatever. We don't use that anymore. We don't, I mean, people paint, yes, of course, I like it as well. But in general, it's not that, it's not like... But we use that and digital media. Maybe it's a new function, new new point of view to see architecture through that our new eyes, the eyes that are used to digital things. Maybe it could also be understood, like, maybe I say too much.
Thank you. Do you have some? Yeah, maybe we go back there. And we now I know a lot of people want to ask questions. Mm-hmm. There is Alex. Yeah, you can went down here and then there.
I'm Rodrigo Rada from Portia, and in a way I'm repeating to what it was said before about that there's that you can't see the media. There's a confusion in the media, and that in a way it's the icon loses its content. But what I want to say that what I see in the building is that it becomes more than an icon, and in a way we sort of are moving from the learning of literal learning to a more a visual learning, that the icon starts representing in a way the our times. That, and by losing, you said that what would the woman be, it doesn't really matter. And in a way, images have been degenerated through digital back to a concise material, that in a way it doesn't really matter what media it is and what we're going to understand, but in a way they leave something for you to interpret it, and they leave something for you to start learning from this experience that in a way is turning the building inside out. It's talking about that enigma of the book, putting it right forward into a visual image then instead of into an enigmatic.
Thank you. Thanks for that comment. Maybe we go here, there, and here, and then I'll ask Jacques to make a comment. Just to the front here, please.
That's a very interesting question. In fact, we always liked the fact that we could never achieve an image with a clarity which is could compete with something that you print on paper and has sharp contours and edges. So from the very beginning, even if the last tests were providing quite good pictures, but from the very beginning it had slightly fading elements, like pre-washed jeans or so. So, I mean, this element of something which is not so aggressively there is there from the beginning. And, of course, everything fades away. Everything. And I think we have to accept that. But I wouldn't interpret this as a philosophical sort of... It's just an aesthetic preference, you know.
But all aesthetic preferences become philosophical.
Yeah, of course, absolutely.
Can you maybe, since we're near here, we go to Tamara and then we can go to... Yeah.
Tamara Jacobs.
Speak up.
Tamara Jacobs, and then fifth year student. I'm very curious with respect to all the subjects that you brought up this evening on the display of the work in the Tate Gallery with regards to the display of either icons or images on your building. So one thing would be, what was actually your approach towards displaying the works of art with regards to what you were saying about people wanting them to have their names, because it's a very important part of a work of art. Then other than that, I'd like to know about the flexibility of the display inside the building and maybe the use of the larger parts of the building for displaying art as well.
In the Tate?
Yes. Because I mean, I also read some criticism about the displaying of the work of art, and I'd like to know what you think about it, actually. What I found very, very interesting is that some of the very, very big photographs that are hung in between spaces seem a bit strange to approach because they're very, very close up to your face and they almost make you only read the name of the artist. But that actually when you go up the escalators, then you manage to experience the work. So it actually engages you with the building back again. But I would like to know quite a bit about, you know, your approach to the images of the works of other people in your building.
That's interesting questions. First of all, we are the architects and not the curators. And there are more successful and less successful areas in the spaces. Some of the galleries, purely architecturally spoken, are also more interesting than others. But basically, I think it's, if you compare it to any museum in the world, it's quite a range of different spaces in a non-hierarchical way in different floors. So the idea was to have any kind of art on any floor, anywhere almost, where each particular piece of art could express itself. So we want to give everything to the work of art. At the same time, we are not neutral, so the spaces have their own character, and some of these spaces are very difficult for some works of art. Let's take the double height space where the voice is in. You couldn't have everything there. So, I mean, very clearly, a building is always in a dialogue with the works of art, otherwise it would be stupid space. And certainly I'm not in a position to criticize what the curators have done, but some spaces clearly are not what we would have liked to have. But some others, on the contrary, are fantastic, I think. Just like the ones you mentioned, I think to use those areas which are not meant to be galleries like the concourses where the escalators go up, and you perceive the photographs of Thomas Ruff, by the way, or Andras Gorski, yeah, or Stutt, through the glass. The artists, I mean, Gorski had a problem with this. I told him, listen, this is the fucking best space because everybody sees this, and it's very, very visual, you know. Why should you always have a picture in front of you? You stand on the floor and you see every single detail. That's an ideal position, but it's also right to use something which is meant to be on the wall, maybe sometimes in a different way, and the work of art gets a different dynamic, a different energy. So maybe you see just a frame or some fragment of it, but you see it as an entire piece when you go up the escalator. Of course, if this is the only way and the only moment when you can see that, it wouldn't be good. But in the case of the Tate, I think this is one of the more successful parts, these concourses. Very lively, where really movement, different people are merging with the world of the artist.
Thank you. Can you, for the last question maybe we have here?
We could, of course, say much more about the different things, but basically, that's what we try to achieve.
This is perhaps a more common than the question, but maybe an interesting response. Your buildings, Jacques, have been very provocative. Certainly, there have been a number of conferences around the world where people have begun to talk about them as in raising new issues about how we deal with surface, how we identify the buildings, particularly from the Deleuzean perspective, and so on. It seems to me that what's very productive about your work is that it is precisely raising questions. It is unsettling. It's unsettling because it challenges along a lot of modernist paradigms about how we handle surface. And I think that is probably a good thing in itself. Secondly, which I find sort of unsettling is through the very use of repetition. And repetition, we know from various authorities like the Mibaba, is itself something that's meant to be unsettling in itself. Parody, political satire is based on repetition of sort. So I think that throughout this work there is something deeply unsettling and that provokes a number of questions, and that in itself I think is the refreshing positive side. So if the work is enigmatic in a way, I find that as something quite positive.
This is more of a comment, as you said. The unsettled moment is
I think, something very welcome, for me at least.
Maybe we just finish with the first year student back there, and then anybody else can ask questions upstairs.
What was the last statement? The relationship between architecture and fashion and?
And whether architecture should be fashionable or not.
Whether it should be fashion or not?
Fashionable.
Fashionable.
Fashionable, yeah.
I love it.
Well, I think that today in our contemporary culture, art, fashion, even sport, architecture, literature, film, these different ways to express yourself have common points, are touching each other. We are closely working with Prada, for instance, with a fashion company. And not only that we do some buildings for them, but it's really interesting discussions on, they are launching a cosmetic line this fall. And they will now work on a perfume, and we might be involved in these things, namely in a way that we discuss these things. And of course, what you do ultimately is a building or a perfume or a dress. And it's interesting to discuss these in a kind of crossover, but at the same time, you have to be aware that you do a building and not a dress or not a perfume when you do a building, because only if the building is really works as a building, it's interesting. But of course, you can learn from fashion and art and vice versa. That's all I can say. And this is more so than it has been 5, 10, or 20 years ago. You know, only the world of film and architecture is not really related yet, and also pop music and architecture. I don't know any pop star who has built a decent house so far. Do you? Strangely.
Really?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Jacques. Thank you all, Mark, Andrew. For those of you who didn't manage to get your copies of the book signed, Jacques has volunteered to spend another few minutes upstairs doing a little bit more book signing in the same room, in the front members room.
Did you call him?
Yeah.
Did you?
Yeah. I asked the student to go on.
So I go on?
Yeah, you go to the
refugees.
You take this all.
Okay.
Oh.